Hello, I'm Sabine O'Hara, Dean of the University of the District of Columbia's College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability, and Environmental Sciences. Welcome back to Causes. The College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability, and Environmental Sciences offers academic programs in nutrition, dietetics, nursing, health education, architecture, and environmental sciences. And we serve thousands of residents in every ward of the District of Columbia through our research-based community education and land grant center programs in nutrition, diet, and health, sustainable development, urban agriculture, architectural research, and youth development. Our cause's motto is Healthy Cities, Healthy People. To accomplish this, we work to make our academic programs relevant, our land grant centers accessible, and we seek strong partnerships with our city government. Joining me to talk more about a healthy city, healthy people, are Harriet Tregoning, Director of the DC Office of Planning, and UDC's Professor Kathy Denise Dixon, Associate Professor of Architecture and Community Planning. Welcome, Harriet and Kathy. Thank you for joining me.
Pleasure to be here.
Thank you for having me.
Harriet, I'm going to start with you. Healthy cities, healthy people. It seems like that motto was tailored for you because you have been one of the people who's been spearheading the Sustainable DC initiative in your office. And of course, as I read that program, that its objective, it has sort of healthy cities, healthy people all over it.
That's absolutely true. When we developed this initiative, which really came from Mayor Gray, with the intention of making the District of Columbia the healthiest, greenest, most livable city in the country in just a generation, so by 2032, one of the overarching challenges, we had four challenges we were trying to address. One of them was health and wellness. Mm-hmm. And that's very important for every household in the city. Everyone thinks about this. And there are lots of things that you can do in a city that build healthy living easily into your daily routine, as opposed to having to make extra special efforts to maintain your health and wellness.
Mm-hmm. You know, it seems to me, as most of you know, I'm originally from Germany, and it always strikes me when I visit my family over there. I visited my mom, who is 85 now. But it seems like in some of the European cities, that's sort of much more built in, because my 85-year-old mom still walks to the market, right, to do her daily shopping. And the idea that you might shop for the whole month is just unheard of.
Well, I think that's very much how our city is evolving. And I think what we've seen, especially in the last 10 years, is convenience and services, retail in almost every neighborhood. And that's mm-hmm. certainly our goal in the planning office, to bring that kind of convenience so that people can meet their daily needs in their own neighborhood, often on foot, or a very short bike or transit ride away.
Mm-hmm. Kathy, how does that figure into our architecture and community planning program here at UDC?
Yes, our program is trying to make inroads with the community. We have programs such as we're beginning to do the aquaponics lab launch mm-hmm. in Southeast DC. We're looking at a weatherization program for individuals to weatherize their own homes. The architecture program is constantly looking at opportunities to engage the community in making their buildings and their surrounding environments more efficient, more sustainable, more livable.
Mm-hmm. So planning has really evolved, hasn't it? Because it used to be, you know, we used to think about planning as sort of buildings and roads, and that was about the focus. Well, seems like that has really changed.
I think that the planning has always had kind of a wide scope. I think in different places people think of it more narrowly or more broadly, and we've been fortunate in our city that for more than a dozen years we've thought of planning very, very broadly. Mm-hmm. And we're a city that really has a long planning tradition going all the way back to the founding of our city and the plan of Pierre L'Enfant. Mm-hmm. So it's a city where planning is relatively easy to do, and what I'm happy to see is that it's becoming a very rapid period between a plan and its implementation. Mm-hmm. So even with our Sustainable DC plan that we just announced the implementation of in February, that out of 143 actions that the plan specifies, 66 of them are already underway, and another 23 will be launched by Earth Day of 2014. So we really are getting about the business of trying to make sustainability a reality in the district.
That's very impressive. That's quite an impressive record. What are the main initiatives of the plan?
Well, I mean, we have initiatives in a lot of different areas. The challenges, I'll lay those out first. I mean, this is not a strategy that's about just the environment and about just being green. It's about fundamentally reshaping our economy and making sure that we have a diverse range of jobs at every education level, every skill level. That's the kind of city that we aspire to be. It's about health and wellness, as we've already talked about. It's about equity and diversity. So making sure that not just what we do, but how we do it benefits the households and the individuals that have the least. Mm-hmm. And finally, it's about climate and the environment. Mm-hmm. And the solutions are taking place in how we build and what we build, in the energy we use and how efficiently, in the food that we grow and that we eat, and making sure that healthy choices are available. It's in nature. Both protecting our habitat, but increasing the access that children in particular have to nature every day. It's about transportation, expanding the options that people have, and making sure that every Washingtonian has many low-cost transportation options that give them access to the entire city and the entire region for jobs and for services. It's about water, stormwater management, conserving water, but also cleaning our rivers. And finally, it's about reducing waste. We have a zero waste goal for the city, mm-hmm. To repurpose and reuse and reduce the waste that we produce and what we do end up disposing, trying to put that into a productive stream of some other kind.
Mm-hmm. Seems like you've almost written the script for causes for this college, you know, because those are exactly the pieces that we have been putting in place as well. And of course, they're all somehow linked, right? You can't think about the green economy without looking at both the high tech and the less skilled, without food production, health and exercise belong together, as does nutrition. It's all
I don't think
very
it's an
connected.
Accident. As you know, you were you and many people from UDC were very actively involved in the plan, in developing the plan, which we greatly appreciate, and we were delighted to have, you know, hundreds and hundreds of people participate from around the city. So we feel like we also have a lot of support, and we've got just tremendous input. There's a lot of interest and excitement about the future of the city, especially with respect to making it more sustainable.
Yeah. Kathy, you've been nodding.
No, I agree with what you said. It speaks to the evolution of sustainability, like you mentioned. Initially, I was licensed as a LEED certified accredited professional 10 years ago, before it was a very popular thing to do. And at that time, it was only speaking about the environment and green. Today, it's more about social issues, social equity, equitable development, and the interdisciplinary nature of sustainability. And I think that's how causes reflects the change that's happening.
Yeah, when we talk about sustainable development as we define it in this college, we talk about the concentric circles of the economy, society and culture and the environment, and they're sort of like nested systems. They're all connected, but it's sheer impossible to think of them without looking at how they impact each other, right? How the economy impacts how people live and the access they have to resources, and how that in turn impacts the environment, because so many of the choices are really impacted by access to economic resources and to societal resources. So that interesting topic that you raised as part of the plan, namely, we are a pretty bifurcated city. And so both in terms of maybe awareness, but also opportunities. It's all over the map, it seems.
And it seems clear that we're not going to be in a different place unless we act very deliberately to make it so. So I think that what's important about the Sustainable DC plan is that it's basically about a smarter government, a government that's working to get a wider array of options. I think when we were a country that was wealthier, we could afford to spend $1 and solve $1 worth of problems. we now have to spend a dollar and solve $4 or $5 worth of problems. Mm-hmm. And I think that actually makes us a much better city and our services much better. Mm-hmm. One example of a small sustainable DC initiative that we're doing right now is the police department has cruisers that idle when they have to be doing work. You know, from inside those cruisers, they're all kitted out with all kinds of electronics, and they spend the patrol officers spend a lot of time in those cruisers. So we've put on devices that that allow them to access their electrical systems, but without having to run their gas-powered engines. So that makes sense, right? That'll probably save a lot of money, a lot of fuel, a lot of greenhouse gases. But you know what? We're implementing this program first in the places in the city that have the highest asthma rates. So that will, even how we do it is intended to try to have the greatest impact on the places where the problems are the greatest. And the problem is now framed larger. It's not just the fuel efficiency and the cost savings for the police. It's what is the impact in the larger community mm-hmm. that idling engines have. So mm-hmm. I think it's a small example, but a good example of how sustainable DC is not just what, but it's how we do things.
Yes. And of course, I'm very interested too in the initiatives that you've taken in really building real neighborhoods, in bringing services back very deliberately into some neighborhoods, because that of course also has a health impact, because if people have things in walking distance, as you said, it brings exercise almost like built in into the daily routines.
Yeah. I mean, every transit trip is in part a walk trip. Mm-hmm. And about 96% of our DC residents are within a quarter mile of some kind of transit. Could that be more frequent? Could it be better service? Certainly. But we start in a very good place that a lot of other cities, don't have. And as a consequence, even though we have obesity issues in the city, the obesity rates for the cohorts that might normally have the highest rates of obesity in any part of the country, low-income households, they're much lower in the District of Columbia than they are nationally. And so I think that's because we have already begun to build in healthier options, physical activity, more and more mm-hmm. into the daily routine. And even things like better public safety, less crime, those mm-hmm. things also have a huge impact on how comfortable people feel getting their daily activity by walking around outside or going to a park mm-hmm. or just being able to be anywhere in the city.
Mm-hmm. Kathy, you mentioned another interesting project that we're involved with very much here at Causes and at UDC, and that's the launch of an aquaponics facility in Ward 8. Mm-hmm. Right off Martin Luther King Avenue, or right on Martin Luther King Avenue, but in the alley behind. And that's kind of an unusual project. So we've been launching these initiatives very interdisciplinarily, very collaboratively between environmental science and architecture and urban ag. So that's kind of a bit unusual, and I'm sure you may have received some similar reactions, Harriet, with the Sustainable DC plan, when there's food production highlighted in a city plan. So what's all that about? Because that's not how people usually think about agriculture.
Right. I think that, again, we go back to connectivity and interrelated disciplines. We're talking about health when you're talking about food. We have to look at it from the growth, agricultural, how do we grow food in the city? Again, architecture can play a role in how that happens. I think I have to commend you for growing that relationship with the church in Southeast, that we
Thank
can
you.
Have those opportunities to do to work with the community and do those types of things, and we'll continue to find other opportunities like that.
Mm-hmm. How are the students responding? Are they interested?
The students are very interested. Any kind of any way that they can make a difference, they want to mm-hmm. help, and we have some volunteers for that event mm-hmm. that will come out. So
great.
Very looking forward to it. We also have student chapter of the USGBC Green Building Council that will be helping, assisting with that event mm-hmm. as well.
Great. Mm-hmm.
And that's very exciting.
And I try to not use any acronyms without asking you what they mean. And same with aquaponics. So aquaponics really refers to a way of raising fish and using the excrement of the fish as fertilizer for plants. So the system we have constructed there on Martin Luther King Avenue using a grant that we received from Wells Fargo is a closed loop system, so there is no waste. And we were able to do it because one of our environmental science professors has a patented aeration device that puts oxygen from the air into the water using very innovative processes. And that has allowed us to bring the usually swimming pool size fish tanks down to the size of a bathtub. The tanks are about the size of this table, that's all. And so, you know, with this high level of oxygen, we can now really grow fish and vegetables very, very efficiently in very small environments. And so it's kind of an exciting, exciting project, and we hope to build more all over the city, especially in areas where we have food deserts. That's another interesting term that I'm sure you wrestle with your fair share, right? How does one address these deficits that we have in some of our neighborhoods?
Absolutely. I mean, the city has actual financial incentives to encourage grocery stores to locate in parts of the city that are not well served by full service groceries. But you know, it's no surprise that that the city's first commercial hydroponic greenhouse, has been announced in Ward 8, kind of right at the tip of the city, and maybe there's a relationship there between the fertilizer that gets produced from your aquaponics project and the hydroponic greenhouse that we expect to grow about 1 million pounds of fruits and vegetables every year. Yeah. So I think those are both projects that bring jobs. But also bring fresh and healthy food to the city, and there are industries that we just have never had here.
Yeah.
So that's all very exciting, very much in keeping with what Sustainable DC wants to accomplish,
yeah.
And you know, getting several different positive outcomes from the city from a single investment.
Yeah, and you know, we very much want to be part of that, and are, as you said, we've been part of it already through the planning phase, and so have been looking at your goals and objectives of the plan to see where can we plug in, where do we have maybe a bit of a niche. What I thought was interesting, you know, when we first shared this idea with you all in architecture, the first question that we got was, because you know, the tanks, of course, the fish tanks are in a hoop house. It's a very light construction, movable sort of thing, and they all look like this. They all look like hoops. And so the first thing some of the architecture colleagues asked was, well, does it have to look like this, right? Or are there ways to...
Right. What are the opportunities to make it a little more aesthetic to the environment?
So. Yeah, and more fitting into an urban context, you know.
Well, it's interesting the fact that they are kind of temporary and very movable, because part of the urban condition is at any given moment to have quite a bit of vacancy in the city.
Yeah.
Even in the boomingest times of the city's recent history, we've had sites like the old convention center that that were essentially set vacant with some temporary uses, but for more than 9 years. But in any given moment, we might have empty ground floors of buildings. We might have a temporarily vacant lot while a project gets entitled. And those are all opportunities to bring temporary uses that might both introduce people to a new industry, teach them about sustainability, but also potentially create some jobs in a neighborhood that needs them.
Mm-hmm. The challenges moving forward, I think, have to do with how the growing the food in the city in an urban environment. How does that look architecturally, as well as you said, the temporary issues. And then the challenge of making sure that the people in those areas are involved in the development of those projects. The underrepresented people have to be able to benefit from the economic development that someone else is typically benefiting from.
So. Right, right. Mm-hmm. That's why, you know, the approach that we take is have very close partnerships in those communities through our land grant centers. And then with those partnerships, you know, we really bring the ideas, we share them, we sort of bat them around. But the goal is always to use these projects and the implementation process as training opportunities to train lab technicians, food safety certifications in this case, right? But you know, to actually then turn the project over. We don't intend to run all of them, right? We just find both the design of the project and the funds to implement them, but then to also provide the training so that they can be sustainable and that they can be run by these neighborhoods.
That would be great. I mean, the one thing that we have in abundance in Washington these days is restaurants.
Yes.
And so it would be interesting to look at some partnerships with some of those establishments. And I see several potential small businesses in an idea like this.
Yeah. You know, we have one relationship here at the college itself, our research farm out in Beltsville, where we are very intentional about growing nutritional food that has very high nutritional density. And we have a relationship with the Hay Adams for that food, because the chefs will tell you there is a big difference between vegetables that have high nutritional density and vegetables that have water, right? Because then you have a frying pan full of water, and they change color and so forth. And so the chefs are the first ones to tell us there is a big difference in how things are grown and also how they are stored. If we minimize transportation time, there is a big difference.
Absolutely.
And health benefits from that. So one other thing you mentioned, Harry, that I don't want to lose track of completely is water, because that is another big issue, of course, and the stormwater system in the city, of course, is a big challenge as well with its age, or some of our aging infrastructure. But I think in general, there is more of an awareness now in cities across the country that maybe blacktop is not the end all of surfaces, even in cities.
So I think that our aging infrastructure in many respects is going to turn out to actually be an advantage for the city, because we are absolutely taking steps, making investments to address those things. So we already have the most stringent stormwater regulations in the country.
Mm-hmm.
So you're going to see more innovation around how that water is managed here than anywhere else. And as you're saying, this isn't a problem that's unique to Washington. So our innovations, we think, will have markets that are regional, national, and global mm-hmm. for the innovations that we come up with. So we think this is going to be a very fruitful and innovative time for us and for potential small businesses, and we think there'll be a ton of job creation associated with it, because we are going to retrofit the entire city with green infrastructure. And that is that's a big change, and it'll do a lot of things. It'll manage stormwater, but it'll also make the city more beautiful. It'll make it cooler. You know, in a time of global warming where the hard surfaces in the city really hold the heat and make it even hotter in the summertime than the surrounding jurisdictions, it'll be home to nature. It'll be habitat. It'll do a lot of things. It'll provide opportunities to grow food and bring that very close to people who would then be able to enjoy that food. So yeah, we're really looking forward to this next couple of years when it comes to green infrastructure and managing our stormwater.
Mm-hmm. Kathy, low impact development, right, is sort of the heading for some of those initiatives.
Right, right. Architects can make a big difference in that area when we're designing new buildings, site planning, site layout. I think at a basic level, people need to be educated on their water use. I know we've been talking about this for years, but still I think people can do better, and the way we design our buildings will assist them in doing better mm-hmm. in that regard.
So give us some examples of what that low impact development might look like. We've been saying permeable surfaces, you say beautification, growing food, more gardens, more dirt rather than
green
black
roofs.
Green roofs
is the first and most obvious example.
Right. Yeah.
Using native plant material, mm-hmm. The permeable pavement, like you mentioned, the rain gardens and basins like that direct the water away from move it before it gets to the sewer systems. So those methods are what are in use right now for low impact development.
Harriet, are there a couple of sites already in the district if people want to see what a rain garden looks like, for example? Where should they go?
I would direct people to go to Canal Park in mm-hmm. Southeast Washington, near the, in the Capitol Riverfront area near the ballpark. So this is a 3-block long park that actually manages, it collects and manages all the water that drains from the 3 blocks that surround the park. It filters that water and it recirculates it in fountains at the park and in water features, but it also is used to irrigate the lawn and the plants that are there. Do you know that we're using drinking water right now mm-hmm. to do irrigation? We use drinking water to flush our toilets. I mean, we treat it to a level that isn't necessary. We pay for it. And at the same time, it costs us a lot to have that stormwater that we're not otherwise capturing, go into our combined sewer system and in big rainfall events flush out, human waste into mm-hmm. the, into our rivers. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot that all of us can do. Even something as simple as a rain barrel mm-hmm. that collects the water from a hard roof, mm-hmm. and use that to water your lawn or wash your car. Those are small steps that everyone can take. Mm-hmm. But we're going to see a lot of this around mm-hmm. the city and. And there are many, many examples. We put on more green roof in our city in the last 2 years, each of the last 2 years, than any city in America.
And of course, one of those green roofs is right here on our
it
campus,
is,
the
an
plaza
enormously
here
large
at
green roof.
UDC. Well, thank you both very, very much for a very engaging conversation and very informative, I hope, for our viewers. My guests today have been Harriet Tregoning, Director of the DC Office of Planning, and Kathy Dixon, Associate Professor of Architecture here at UDC. If you would like more information about our topic or about the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia, please visit our website at www.udc.edu-causes. Thank you for watching. I'm Sabine O'Hara. See you next time on Causes.